I'm going to talk a little bit about the funding gap and also why it is important that we fix it. Little bit about me. Janneke, I'm an entrepreneur. I just started a VC fund together with Eva de Mol, where we focus on selecting the best team based on a model that's based on scientific research. I'm active as an angel investor. I'm in the board of a few companies also, Codem. I don't know if the people of Codem are still here or if you met them. Otherwise, please, please do. I have two kids, and I mention it specifically because I get to be told very often that I'm a horrible mom because I work more than full-time, having had my own business for the last 20 years. And I always think, well, as long as they look as happy as they do, please keep talking. So it is very well possible to combine these two things, and like some politicians we don't need to mention told us this week. So the funding gap, what are we actually talking about? What are the numbers? Well, you can see here the Dutch numbers versus the international numbers. And in the Netherlands, only 1.6% of VC funding goes to all female teams. Which is even worse than the already horrible international number. If you look, well, a few percent, 6.8, goes to diverse teams, and everything else goes to white guys, basically. Because this number focuses on gender, but diversity, as we all know, is much broader than that. But the numbers in the Netherlands were so low on that, that we couldn't even significantly show them. So a lot to do here. When you look at VC funds who hand out this money, their numbers don't look great either. Only 6%, 5.7 to be precise, of partners at VC firms, and those are the ones that make the decisions, are women. Everybody else is a man. And in fact, they are all white guys. 87% of VC firms has zero female partners, so in all male firms. When you then know that VC funds that have more diverse partner teams invest more diverse, you have a little bit of an explanation of the previous slide. So while these numbers are really horrible, I want to share another shocking and depressing detail. And that is that in 2018, all female founders combined received 10 billion less in funding than an e-cigarette company. Let that one sink in, an e-cigarette company. I think we can all agree that those companies don't really contribute a lot to the world, but they get more funding than all women combined. In fact, 10 billion more. So I think it's clear what the funding gap is. So why is... Oh, I had a different font, but that's fine. why is this a problem? It is a problem because of financial reasons. The data is very clear. Diverse teams perform better financially. So it's still unknown to me how we all leave this at the table. We miss opportunities. We don't use a lot of potential out there by just investing in men and in non-diverse teams. So that's reason number one why it's a problem. Another big problem is that VCs fund the future. If you look at the most valuable companies out there today, most of them started with VC funding. So VCs decide which companies get the opportunity to grow and continue to expand into the world. And I think it's wrong that a small homogeneous group basically has a monopoly on innovation, that they decide what products and services we use. And the future should be built by all of us and decided by all of us. The lack of diversity in tech leads to a less inclusive society, where not everybody has the same opportunities, and where products and services are not very inclusive either. It creates a culture and an economy where women are disadvantaged to building companies and raising a capital. So you might know already some of these examples, but one that, well, people often think is very funny, and I think it's not, is robots. Robots are trained through image recognition, and images are labeled. And what they found is that stereotypes were actually increased by these labels. All the images that were related to cooking, cleaning, taking care of kids were labeled female. All the images that had to do with sports and leadership were labeled male. So also a man behind a stove was labeled female. So what happens when you don't interfere and let this just continue? Let's assume you're a traditional family, a husband, wife, and you both work and you have a robot at home. So you come home after a long day of work as the wife, and the robot says, "Hi, how was your day? Shall I help you with the laundry?" While at the same time, the husband comes home and the robot says, "How was your day? Would you like a beer?" So where you would hope technology would actually neutralize all these stereotypes, it amplifies them. But it can get even dangerous. When you look at healthcare, historical data is basically based on white men. The fact that women have different bodies, people from with different backgrounds have different bodies, is something that we only acknowledged recently. And people think that algorithms are neutral. They are not, because they are created by people and input data is hardly ever neutral. So in this case, when you mainly use, in healthcare AI, you use data about white men. If you're not a white man, you can simply die. But also the racist soap dispenser. Those things happen when you don't have a diverse workforce. I don't know if you're familiar with this example, but the soap dispensers where you put your hand and you don't have to touch anything and then soap automatically comes at your hand, they don't work for people of color. And that's because of the reflection that's necessary to see that there's a hand. If you would have a diverse group of people working on a product like that, you would have found that before you shipped it to the market. But that's why you very often see people of color using a napkin to get actual soap. So there's a lot of horrible examples. There's a few great books written about it. Don't read them to cheer you up because they are very depressing, but we need to know what is wrong in the world to actually fix it. So still I would read it. Yes, so when we did this research, we got a lot of feedback. It sort of exploded in the media, and there were questions asked in Parliament, and actions are taken, which is good. But we got a lot of really positive feedback from women who feel supported, who recognize that it's difficult to get funding, who recognize the horrible situations they find themselves in sometimes. We got really positive feedback of some men who also feel that the numbers are bad and want to know what they can do to fix it. Hooray for them. But we also got a lot of crazy comments of men who think we should stop whining and go back to the kitchen. These are the people, I think, they don't get it, they don't want to get it, and they will never get it. But the good thing is, they will become extinct. The biggest group, and also an important group, is the group that feels attacked. And they feel they get somehow blamed for something they feel they are not part of, they can't do anything about, they didn't do intentional. It's just what it is. And they tend to come up with a lot of reasons why the research is flawed, why the numbers are not as bad as they look. But no matter how you look at it, 1.6%, pretty bad. And they come up with reasons why they are not to be blamed. And I don't think anybody specifically should be blamed. I don't think it makes a lot of sense to continue to look at the past, but with this information and knowing what we know, we can look at the future and change things. But let's look at the reasons they come up with, why the research actually is not good and definitely not their fault. First of all, women are not good enough because investors, they just want to make a good return. So if women would be good entrepreneurs, they would invest. Well, of course, wrong. Scientific research shows that there are many reasons why women get less funding than the fact how they perform. There is, in fact, research that shows women are better entrepreneurs, but that's not a debate we need to have, but we are definitely not worse entrepreneurs. Network, bias, and stereotypes really influence the amount of money women get, but also the fact if they get funding at all. So in VCs, they invest in what they know, who they recognize, what they understand. And so if you come up with a product they don't get, they won't invest. And that's also how, for example, really successful a company in the US, Stitch Fix, they went IPO last year or the year before, they hardly could get any funding because the VC just didn't get it until he found that his office manager spent almost her entire salary on that company. Then he thought, could be something. And in the meantime, this company was making already tens of millions in revenue. So women are also judged different than men. A young woman, inexperienced. A young man has potential. A woman with a nice car, what is she going to do with her money? A man with a nice car, well done. Women get different questions. They get backward-looking questions. Men get forward-looking questions. And if you answer these questions, as a woman, you're talking about the past, about things you might have done wrong. And as a man, you get the opportunity to talk about the future and your vision, and you come across as thinking big. So the only way to turn that around is to be aware of that and actually turn these questions around. And when they ask, how did things go in the past, you just start talking about the future. VCs tend to invest in the same deal around the same time with people, again, they know through work or college. So it's really a small, a very small world. So it's definitely not that women are not good enough. There are so many other things that impact this atmosphere. It's the pipeline, the famous pipeline that we like to blame so many things on. Also, in this case, people say there's just not enough female entrepreneurs. Well, I think it's fair to say in tech it's not 50-50, but it definitely is not 1.6 versus over 90% either. So if you look at entrepreneur numbers in general, it's 30%, over 30% are female. In tech, it's 15 to 20%, so a huge gap with 1.6%. They don't knock on our doors. Well, it's not just a false statement, it's also a lazy statement. What is the last time you found an investor in their office waiting for entrepreneurs to come by? Never. They're always on the lookout for the next big thing, for the next entrepreneur that is going to make it. So if you don't have a diverse pipeline, you just don't have an inclusive strategy. And you should wonder what is wrong maybe with your messaging, with your approach. A good example is this US investor that is talking about pitching on a stage. And he says, if you want to pitch me, I don't like meeting rooms. You come to my house upstate and you can pitch with a beer in my hot tub. Imagine who you all exclude with this approach, aside from people that are just not happy being in a bathing suit in general in a business context, but people that don't drink, people that don't feel comfortable being alone, well, many things you can think of. Women don't do technical studies. That one we heard a lot. Well, I think, especially here at the high-tech campus, it's fair to conclude that that's not true. But it's also, although it is a very good idea to do a tech study, it's not necessary to do a tech study to do a to start a tech company. The biggest entrepreneur in the world, and one of the most famous ones, Steve Jobs, didn't do a technical study. His co-founder did. It's about the team. You need a lot of different skills to be a successful company. Two of the most celebrated Dutch entrepreneurs, Pieter van der Does and Pieter Zwart, didn't do a technical study either. There's not enough data. We need more data. We need to know how many women applied. Otherwise, we can't use this data. Again, nonsense. More data is nice. It will give you more hooks to take action. But you can still see the problem, or, well, in fact, the big opportunity with these numbers. And there's already many things you can do to fix it without more data. XYZ is the problem. I think after today especially, we can all agree that diversity is a complex challenge. There's many reasons, many factors, many stakeholders, but there's always you. And there's always something you can do to make the world a better place. And you don't need to wait for everybody else or for others to move to do what you already can do today. We also need men. This is something we need to solve together. We need to create awareness, we need their support to fix it, because still they are very often in positions where they can fix things, where they can contribute to solutions. And a lot of time, the bias they have is unconscious. They are not aware. There are not a lot of men that I meet that say, I just don't want to invest in women. None of them say that. But what they don't realize is that there are many things that make them not invest in women. And it's important to continue to give them examples. I've noticed that the men that are willing to change actually at a certain point get it. And then they become very active into changing it. The ones that don't, leave them, they will never again, they will go extinct. If she can see it, she can be it. I really believe that role models are key in increasing diversity in tech. And it's very often also a case if he can see it, she can be it. Because, well, again, men play a role in this whole change. But we need to change what a successful entrepreneur looks like. The stereotype of a white guy in a hoodie is not suitable, and it's not true. But as long as we continue to invest only in white men, they are the only ones that become successful, and they seem more bankable. So you get into this vicious circle. So it's really important to make sure that we get more different role models. And I want to show a short video to explain that.
This afternoon, we're going to draw people doing different jobs. And the first job we're going to draw is a firefighter.
Have a think in your head what a firefighter looks like.
What's your firefighter called?
Mine's called Firefighter Gary.
Firefighter Stan.
Firefighter Simon.
He's big and strong.
He's got a big helmet on.
That's brilliant, isn't it?
Next, we're going to draw a surgeon.
Have you thought of a name for your surgeon?
Jim Bob.
Jim Bob.
He's a brain surgeon.
I think he would wear a stethoscope.
He gives you medicine.
That's his ambulance.
Okay, next, we're going to draw a fighter pilot. Yes.
This is his jet plane.
He rescues people.
He likes to do stunts in the air and stuff.
Okay, now, who would like to meet these people for real?
Yeah! Faye, they're dressed up!
My name's Tamsin, and I'm a surgeon in the NHS.
My name's Lauren, and I'm a pilot in the Royal Air Force.
My name's Lucy, I'm a firefighter in the London Fire Brigade.
So who wants to know how to do an operation?
Who's putting it on? Everyone's
we'll find my stethoscope.
We'll put this in here.
What does it look like?
There you go. Now you're a proper fighter pilot.
So into your ears. Can you hear that?
Yeah.
It's really good.
It's much
better,
here.
Yeah, it's much better than the kids' one.
Got
I think it's actually pretty bad video, but it shows so clearly how important role models are. And I also want to share something of my own experience, because I thought I was a pretty awesome role model for my kids. I'm an entrepreneur, I'm financially independent, I work in tech. Well done. Not so much. We were having dinner, and my oldest son said, Dad, when I grow up, I also want to go in the military. Before my husband joined the ocean cleanup, he was in the military. So, and now he's an even bigger hero because he saves all the animals in the ocean. But that aside, he wanted to go in the military. And I was like, what? So I said, why? What do you think mommy does for a living? You're a princess. Okay. I wanted to cut him some slack. So I said, well, what do you think a princess does all day? Dancing. Okay, and then I left again for a work trip, and he said, happy holiday, mom. And there I was, okay, thinking to be this awesome role model, but I wasn't. I was a dancing princess that went on holiday. And then I realized it's pretty obvious that he has no clue what I do. I'm on the phone, I'm behind my laptop, I'm gone all the time, I don't wear a uniform, so how can he possibly know what I do? So I started explaining more about the work I do, and it's, well, they are still pretty small, so I said I'm an inventor with computers, and that came across well. They understood and they thought that was cool. And when I go on trips now, not on holiday, on work trips, I make videos of what I do. So they understand a little bit more about my life, and I hate making videos, especially of myself, but it does work, because months after, we were having dinner again, and he said, Mom, you're really smart, huh? Because you're an inventor. And I was like, yes. And then the little one said, yeah, and you're a princess. And then I was like, okay, that's fine, princess and inventor, I can live with that. But it's so important to explain what we do when it's not super obvious. And that's also a very small thing that I always tell people. We tend to tell our boys that they are smart, and we tend to tell our girls that they are pretty. And while it's fine to tell a girl that she's pretty, please also tell her that she's smart. Because at a very young age, they already start believing that technology is not for them, that it's difficult, it's boring, and that they are not capable of it. So we need to make sure they have enough confidence and trust to actually embrace it, and also show to them what it can mean in their future, so they actually see it as a great opportunity for them as well. Last thing is that we all have bias. It's not just for men, it's for women too. And it's important to be aware of your own bias. You can look at these things in two ways. It can be a cold snack on a hot day, or it can be a calorie bomb. So there's always different angles you can look at things. And challenge that with yourself. I want to give, again, a personal example. We were looking for a VP data engineering, and these people are rare. And we got a resume, and I was like, what? Do we get this resume? This is awesome. So this person was in London, and a few of us had phone calls with him, and we all agreed, awesome, hire immediately. So I invited him to come to our head office in Amsterdam, and he said, oh, that's great. There's one thing you need to know. I need a little bit more help because I'm blind. And honestly, my first response was, oh, no, finally the right candidate, and now he's blind. Luckily, my second thought was, well, wait a minute. Isn't it my problem that I have no clue how you can do this work being blind? Then it's his problem, because he obviously can do it. And somebody once told me, all the great people have something. So I decided this was his something. And we hired him, best hire ever. But you can easily miss a great hire because of your own bias. So make sure that you challenge yourself all the time. Thank you.
Yeah. So, who has a question for our tech princess? Is there a question? Yeah, there. Okay. I'm going to throw it. Oh, yeah, sorry.
You didn't practice a lot today.
Yeah, yeah, I did, but it's not really working.
We are still alive. It's okay.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah.
Yes, so I saw the numbers. It was really nice presentation. I really, really enjoyed it. Thank you very much. At the beginning, the numbers were so bad. I was just wondering, what would be one behavior change that we should do? Just the most important one, and also what would be the other most important factor that will influence number? So actually two questions.
Yeah, I think a really important change necessary on the VC side is that they should hire more women and in general more diverse groups of people, because you see a direct impact on the type of companies that get funding. I think as women and as people of color, we don't have time to wait for that. So until that, until the system changes, we need to game the system. So be very aware of the stereotypes and biases on the other end, and play on that sentiment. And that helps. I spoke to a VC and I sent her the TED talk that I spoke about the backward-looking questions and the forward-looking questions, and she started checking when they had meetings how they actually asked their questions. And they only asked backward-looking questions to a female entrepreneur. So what they did, they had a conversation after that meeting because they were all quite negative. And then she said, wait a minute, but we only had these questions. Let's have another meeting, and force herself to only ask the forward-looking questions. After that meeting, they decided to invest because suddenly that company looked so much better. But when you are in a meeting like that and you experience these kind of questions, you actually have to, well, turn them around. But also in the US you have Founders for Change, where founders actually pledge VCs, if you're not diverse, we don't want to work for you. And there is still, well, VCs also fight for great deals, so they do have an impact. It has, at this point, more impact if male founders do that, because that's where they currently invest, and they don't want to miss out on those deals. But that's how we slowly get change. And just all the time talk about it. And that's not always easy, because I'm pretty sure there's quite a few people that hate me. They also, some of them tell me that they hate me. but that's fine. We need to keep addressing it, and we need to put it on the agenda every opportunity we get, because every time you have a few more people that actually see it and that are willing to help change it.
Yeah, but I think you mentioned very clearly that there are some people just never change, right?
Yeah, true.
What happened if they are in the key decision makers? Well, so then, yeah.
The good thing about humans is that they don't have a forever life. but also, markets, I didn't mean it like this.
We know.
Also, when you can't get the right deals anymore, you are forced to change. Also, LPs speak up more often. So the ones that give money to the VCs, they demand a change more often. And also the biggest LPs, that's the European Commission and the Dutch government, if you look at the Netherlands, if they demand more diversity, it will help as well. And you will always have people that don't support it, but there's also still people that think that women should stay at home and take care of kids. So as long as the majority changes, we already make so many big steps that for now I would settle for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Give her a big applause, Janneke Nies.
Thank you.